Right. Good evening and welcome back everyone to fractalview.com. We had a little time zone change tonight, so it's 7 p.m. in Europe instead of 8 and 2 p.m. New York time, and we're excited and delighted that James Egan is with us tonight, who's written many books about the wonderful connection between John Dee and Shakespeare. James' origin is as a photographer and now, of course, as an author. And James and I were just chatting, you know, my excitement, I have lots of excitement here tonight. I'm so glad to hear that someone else is investigating the kind of science connection between John Dee and Shakespeare, as our last presenter, Alan Green, did, and as Terry Burns has been doing for most of her life. But you know me, Vincent Bridges kind of started us on this path, and Vincent and I always had this conversation, does science trump history? And I always said that the science lesson, once you distill it from the history, is the real story of the Maury. But the particular part of the story that James Egan is presenting tonight, one part of it that I particularly enjoy in terms of getting a science lesson from the very exciting history story, connections with John Dee and Shakespeare and the architecture in New England, was his work with the photography part of it. John Dee was studying basically optics, and he recognizes, he called the scintilla, the scintillation of light when it was just right. He recognizes that the light angles itself were how you conjure, and part of the process of calling spirits, the way the light converged, the way the light converged in the crystal, et cetera, the scrying. We suspect Nostradamus's cup was coated with a phase conjugate dielectric to make the light converge. To conjugate is to conjure. That is the question. I don't know if that's Shakespearean. But so actually part of James Egan's show tonight is looking at the triangulation of the light as John Dee apparently designed it in Shakespeare's Tower. And I find that part of this science lesson of history particularly wonderful, that it's become part of James Egan's presentation. And also just a general flavor of this, that really there's a tremendous lesson in what we were discovering about communicating with, you know, conjuring and important angelic beings, etc., with the science of what John Dee was doing, and the fact that that is all embedded, as it were, in Shakespeare. Anyway, so I'm not going to carry on. I'm just grateful that James Egan is with us. But just before I go, I just want to say also that we're going to have some exciting things coming up at fractalview.com. 1 week from today, we have the Global Synchronized Therify Healing Plasma Meditation, accompanied also with an exciting conversation with all of the wonderful Therify practitioners and healers around the world, where we synchronize the world with plasma the way that apparently John Dee was doing with Shakespeare. So without further ado, here is James Egan. It's all yours, James.
Thank you very much for the good intro. It was wonderful. Thank you very much. And for everybody coming from all over the world to listen to me today, I really appreciate it. I've got kind of a long talk. It's going to be 500 slides in the next 2 hours. We will take a break halfway through, but it's kind of rapid-fire presentation. So if you do have seatbelts, I advise you to put them on. So we're going to start with the idea of this new thesis of the Newport Tower. Now, in Newport, Rhode Island, where I live, in the middle of Touro Park, right in the middle of the town, is this old building. It's 28 feet tall, and it's stone and mortar, and it's been there for hundreds of years. Nobody knows who built it. Come on, right in the middle of town. It's hidden in plain sight. You'll see it's down at the bottom here. I've got a little red dot here circling it around, and it has a beautiful view over the Newport Harbor, Goat Island and Jamestown and the mainland of Rhode Island. This is a view looking to the west. And here it is, a little bit wider view. Just over to the side here is the entrance to Narragansett Bay, which leads to the Atlantic Ocean. And so underneath each of these pillars is 3.5 tons of stone that goes 5 feet down to bedrock, giant foundations underneath it. And then you've got beautiful 8 symmetrical arches in this octagonal shape, and they're each connected with beautiful Romanesque arches. And then there are several windows, which I'll talk about, but the total top cylinder is about 2 feet thick. This baby was built to last. It's a huge thing. From up above, you get the idea of its circularity, which you don't get too much from below because you get so close to it. And it's in the middle of park. This is the Channing Memorial Church. And I have a small museum in this building right here, right 50 steps northeast of the tower, the Newport Tower Museum. There's 5 theories over the years about who built this. The Vikings in 1150. the Templars in 1398. The thesis that a fellow by the name of Prince Henry Sinclair came over here and built this. He was in the Templars. And the Chinese in 1421, an author by the name of Gavin Menzies writes that they came in huge ships around the tip of South Africa and came and built this as a pagoda lighthouse. And that his best-selling book, 1421. Is still quite popular. The fourth theory is that it was built by the Portuguese. Miguel Corto Real got shipwrecked and abandoned, and they claim that he built the tower while he was waiting for his brother Gaspar to save him. But the main theory is that it was built by the first governor of Rhode Island, a fellow by the name of Benedict Arnold. Now, this is not the traitor Benedict Arnold. This is his great-great-great-grandfather. There's five generations that separate the trader from this colonial settler. He was one of the first people here in Rhode Island in 1636. And he calls this my stone-built windmill in his 1677 will. Well, it doesn't look at all like a colonial windmill. There's hundreds of those all up and down the coast. And they were all made from wood because it was the carpenters who built them. And they all tapered to the top because they had a turret that had to place the blades so that they could face towards the wind. Well, this one doesn't taper, so it would be a 24-foot turret. It would be too huge to build. Philip Means, who wrote a book on the tower in 1942, says, "This is the most unwindmill-like structure I've ever seen." And he says one of the main reasons is that it has a fireplace in it. Now, right in the center here is this fireplace. It has two flues. They reach 7 inches by 7 inches. They go up the interior and exit on the exterior on the other side. Above these beams, above the pillars are beam sockets. There's one there. There's one on each one. These are beams that made a tic-tac-toe pattern that crisscrossed like that. And so the level of the first floor is right at the height of the arches. And so this floor, this fireplace is a raised fireplace. It's up a foot and a half. That's unusual. Colonial buildings, the hearth is always right on the ground. And then you have the second floor beams and a running mortise that runs around the upper interior of it. So this is a room here, and this room has three windows. This is the northeast window. This is the south window, and I'm photographing from the west window and looking towards the east, towards the fireplace. Well, here's my simulation of what it would look like with the beams in the first floor, and that's where the first floor is. And there's the fireplace, and notice how unusual it is in that it has an arch above it as opposed to a lintel. A lintel is a flat piece that you normally have on a fireplace, and they built this window really close to it on the side. Why didn't they just move the window over? Why does it have to be right there? Well, I'll explain a little bit later. And these are the beam sockets for the second floor and what the second floor room was. So you get this sense of this room in here. And in this room are the three windows, the northeast, the west, and the south. And you'll notice that the sides are splayed. They don't go straight in. This one goes straight in, but these have angled sides. That way light can go right straight through these two windows. Well, in the early 1990s, Professor William Penhallows and a professor of astronomy and physics at the University of Rhode Island studied the tower for 10,000 hours, and he found these astronomical alignments in the windows of the tower. He says, if you come here on December 25th, 1996, that's the day of the winter of the lunar minor, when it's the southernmost of the northernmost risings of the moon. If you stand right here at this bench, position one, look through the west window, out the northeast window, he says you'll see the full moon. He predicted this, that it was going to happen 6 years before it happened. So I went there. I was a professional photographer, and I said, well, if this guy's right, let's check it out. So I went there, and here's the path that the moon took that night, straight through, and sure enough, there's the full moon, went right through both of the windows. There's also what he calls the sun alignment, and for that one, you stand on the north west corner of the park, you look through the west window, through the tower, and out the south window. Those are the two windows that are splayed. And he says, on December 21st every year, the winter solstice, the sun is so low in the sky, it's the only time of year it will appear through these two windows. And sure enough, I went there, and it did. And I've been there for every year since then, and it appears every year like clockwork. So this building was like a calendar. And there it is another year. There's another alignment that happens on the equinox. This is, when the light sun rises directly in the east and sets directly in the west everywhere on Earth. At the end of the day, the sun coming through the west window makes a patch of light right near the fireplace. And so I studied this patch of light, and you see it's a square right here, and it comes up about a half hour before sunset. The patch is directly underneath the fireplace. And then it moves up, and it sets on the right-hand side of the fireplace. There are houses on the west side of the park right now, so it doesn't really work, but you can tell that that it was going to set right on the right-hand side. We could figure out why didn't they put it right in the middle of the fireplace if they were doing this. Here's a picture of it just before it fades, because the houses block it. Well, Professor Penhallow was giving a lecture one day at the tower, and he said that the interior room probably acted like a camera obscura solar disk calendar room. What's that? Camera obscura means dark room. In a dark room with one small hole, the image of what's outside appears on the interior. Everything is upside down and reversed. It's just like a camera. And this is also how our eye operates. We see everything upside down on our retina, and our brain flips it around. So in my studio, which is up on the 8th floor up in Providence, I blocked the window and I had a west view, except for one small hole, and the image of what was outside appeared on the inside, but the most distinct thing was the solar disk, the image of the sun, this round circle. And so I drew circles where it was every minute on this day, and then the next day it had moved over, and I kept drawing circles and measured it for an entire year. And in the summer, the setting sun, just before sunset, was right about here, but it was down the other end of the studio in winter. So I made a camera obscura solar disk at sunset calendar room. Here is the summer side of it here, and then in the equinox is the middle, and then in the winter it's here, and then the spring equinox again. So I took that data and figured out all of the angles and then transferred it to the interior of the tower, because, of course, that changes on different latitudes. And so I had an idea of what it looked like. Now, to simulate that, this is where the setting sun, just before sunset, would be throughout the year. And the direct center, this one right here, is the equinox. And you'll notice it's on the right-hand side of the fireplace, just like the patch of light was. Well, I in order to figure out what it looked like inside of the camera obscura room in the tower, I found this firehouse that was nearby, and up on the top, in this room here, they allowed us to make a camera obscura. It had a view that was similar to the one that the tower once had, looking west over the bay. So my photo assistant and I blocked up this window, set up a large seamless paper that was 9 feet wide, and there was the image of what was happening outside on the inside. Here is Mill Street America's Cup Avenue. This is the solar disk, the image of the sun up in the sky. And the reflection of the light off the water made this scintillating reflection off the water. You've seen this in the late afternoon, about half hour before sunset. You can't even look at it with sunglasses. It's as bright as the sun. But in the camera obscura room, it made this scintillating sort of sparkling on the wall. And so here it is, just the exposure is a little bit darker, and you'll see that it's right there. So this is what the picture looks like if I look straight out the window. It's actually the reflection of the light on the water in the late afternoon. I call it fiery water. Well, this is nothing new. Robert Boyle, a famous physicist in the 1700s, he says, in a darkened room, I use a convex lens to project the image of the sun, image of a river shined on by the sun. It looked like millions of shiny fish scales, which sparkled as the wind, sun, and river changed. He was into fiery water back then. So again, this is where the sun would set on that day. So I pieced all of this stuff together, and here's what I came up with. On that day, just before sunset, this is where the path of the sun, around 5 o'clock, because it would set around 5, about a half an hour before sunset, the solar disk, the image of the sun, would be right underneath the fireplace. That means, here it is, the image, there's the fire, that's what it looks like today, there's the box, but in digitally, I blocked up this window with a black hole, black thing, except for one small hole, and there's the image of what the solar disk would look like. And so that means the fiery water would be in the middle of the fireplace. This happens on the first of Aries. You could start a fire up here inside of it, and you get the fiery water, and here you have the whole solar disk. Well, the first of Aries is the first of the fire signs, and it's just after Pisces, which is a water sign. You're going from water to fire. The fiery water's in the middle of the fireplace. I'm like, whoa, who would have designed something like this? Here is the fiery water display, the fire, and everything's upside down, this image inside of it, and there's the image of the solar disk. So I said, who would have designed something like this? This is not like a colonial windmill thing. Colonial people weren't even into this sort of stuff. So that's the end of the first of the eight episodes here. I'm going to click to number 2, And we will continue in a second this dramatic presentation here. There we go.
James, so what John Dee called scintilla seems to fit here somehow, but scintillate.
Yeah, I mean, I've never seen that scintilla. I'd like to see that, the citation. Is that in the 1720 preface to Euclid, or do you think it's in the Monos Hieroglyphica, or do you think it's a Latin word, because he wrote a lot in Latin? I mean,
I know that it's, I have to check that. Teresa's our academic. I'll try to look it up. I know he used the term, but I think
yeah,
it fits.
Sure. It's totally apt for sure. So the history of the Camera Obscura Solidis Calendarum. Now the Arabs around 1100. First off, Aristotle was interested in the solar disk. He says, why is it in wickerwork we have circular image is underneath instead of square? Well, each one is a circular image of the sun. But it perplexed people until they study around 1100 the idea of optics. Now the Arabs, Al-Hazen and Al-Kindi, they said if you blow out the first candle in this room, the fifth candle blows out in this room. They saw that light traveled in straight lines. A monk named Helperic in 875 says, make a hole in the eastern wall of your room, and on the western wall, draw a circle around where the sun is at sunrise, and you will have a calendar in your room. He was doing the same thing in 1100 that I was doing in my studio in the 2000s. Well, in the Renaissance, Agrippa, Barbaro, they all talked about the camera obscura. Cardano says, add a lens, you'll make things even sharper. And Da Vinci says, and so it is with the pupil. They knew that the eye acted like a camera obscura back then, and they were even using optics. That's when they first invented eyeglasses for people to see with, because in Florence was the great lens-making center. The first image we have of a camera obscura is Gemothricius. He was in the Northern Renaissance, and here he shows in 1544 an eclipse of the sun inside a camera obscura room. Everything's upside down and backwards. Well, one of his students was John Dee. And when John Dee studied with Gemothricius, John Dee's best friend was Gerard Mercator, the best map maker on the continent. These guys shared information. Dee and Mercator were like just buddy buddies. They totally like clicked and shared a lot of information. In the 1700s.
Yeah, and the problem that Mercator was dealing with was projection, how to project the sphere on flatland. So it was a projection problem too, yes.
Absolutely, yeah. He's the one that invented the first globes or designed some of the best globes, and he actually gave two globes to John Dee, a terrestrial one and a celestial one. But in the 1700s, they used these camera obscuras with little rooms as drawing aids to learn the art of perspective. This is Vermeer and Cantaletto. They all used these ideas to try and straighten them out. And then in the 1800s, they put film in the back, and they got the first photographs, Daguerre, and so these. And then you've got daguerreotypes, and then you've got around 1900, George Eastman's Kodak Brownie cameras, and then you get Nikons and Leicas, and now we take pictures of our cell phone. But even in a cell phone, you have to have a camera obscura. That's the way light works. So as I was studying all of this, one day, serendipity happened. I was in the library. Are you seeing the image on that or the text on that?
No.
Maybe it's invisible.
No.
Oh. For some reason the text is not showing on that. It shows up at the beginning.
Oh dear.
Anyways,
it's a conversion.
A conversion thing. Anyways, I'll explain what it is. This is a list of historical names for Narragansett Bay. I was in this. I saw this book in the library. And it said the top, it was Refugio, which is Verrazano called it in 1524. And then the Bay of Santa Baptista, which is the Spanish called it. And then underneath it says the John Dee Bay and River, 1583. I'm like, John Dee Bay and River? What's that all about? And besides, what was it that happened in 1583? So what I did was, I started studying and found out more stuff about this John Dee character, and I was fortunate enough that he was able to come and visit me, and he came with his skull cap on, and he came to talk to me, and he said, "Jim, study this. It's a very important thing, not only for you but for the entire world." So I did study it, and I found out there was a huge effort to colonize the New World in the year 1583, and they came right here to Newport, Rhode Island. And so Dee was the mastermind behind this whole project, this colonization effort. But Dee was smart because he was also one of the greatest navigators at the time. He was helping the Muscovy company help to find their way to Moscow. And he invented what they call the paradoxical compass, which you see a picture of here. And it allowed you to navigate the northern latitudes in the sea where the longitude lines are close together. And this huge compendium that went along with it, this whole thing, very scientific. Well, now you see, John Dee lived in tumultuous times. England had been Catholic for over four centuries. And then with Henry VIII and all of his wives, it was Protestant under Edward VI, who was his son, the boy king. But he only lived for 5 years. He died at age 14, and Bloody Mary comes to the throne. Bloody Mary cuts the heads off the 300 bishops that he had hired, and everybody was Catholic. John Dee gets thrown into jail. His roommate, Bartlett Green, they take him out one day and cut his head off. Well, Dee says, you know, I know an awful lot about theology, and I can be very useful to you. He becomes a Catholic priest for 5 years under Queen Mary, and he worked for Bloody Bonner, the head of the whole thing. John Dee was saving his butt. A lot of the other people, they went to the continent for those years, but he stayed around. And then when Mary suddenly died, Queen Elizabeth comes to the throne, and she asks John Dee to select the most propitious day for her coronation. And John Dee does. He selects January 24th, 1559, for the Great Queen's coronation. We're trying to have some fun here. I know I look like a serious academic, but, you know, we just like joking around. So the Queen says to Dee, will you be my philosopher? And she becomes his philosopher, his main philosopher, and he explains that she's got some troubles in the rain here. It's not just her her auburn hair. It's the fact that Spain has 500 ships in their fleet. England has 22. And England was in serious danger of getting totally wiped out. So he writes these 8 books. In the first book, he says, you should build a navy of 60 to 80 large ships and hire 6,000 seamen and hire what make what's called a petty navy. And then in the second book, he says, this is his paradoxical compass, so he explains that. And in this book here, he says the Queen has a legal right to all of North America, except for Florida, because Spain was in Florida, because earlier Englishmen had been there. And in this book, he coins the term the British Empire. Coins the term, John Dee does. So he says that King Arthur, Prince Madoc, John the Sebastian Cabot, earlier Englishmen had been to the New World and claimed it already for England, so she already had entitlement to the entire continent. So he writes this book. This is the front cover of his book, General and Rare Memorials. And up on the top of it, it says, plura latent quam patent, more is hidden than meets the eye. It's a series of riddles. It's a visual riddle. There on the right, the Queen is guiding the ship of state to the New World. 5 ships have settled, and they come into this river, and they start trading. And down on the bottom right, this little city is developed. And up in the sky, Yahweh, God, the sun, the moon, and St. Michael, everything's in order for do that. He calls this a hieroglyphicon Britannicon. That's what it says around the edge of it. And right in the middle of it, the people of England are pleading. They say this right here on their knees, estolos esplistos menos, tostes esprodian throion, which in Greek means send forth a sailing expedition to build a steadfast watch post. And here's the watch post. Here's Lady Occasion, Lady Luck holding the crown of victory, and the Queen is reaching out for the crown of victory. She basically is saying, seize the day, and everything will work out fine. Well, a month later, she deeds all of North America to her most one of her bravest courtiers in the war in Ireland. This fellow, Sir Humphrey Gilbert, has been fighting in the war in Ireland for the Queen for over 4 or 5 years, and he made a proposal to try and settle the New World. And the Queen said, I quite like that idea. And so she deeds all of North America to Sir Humphrey Gilbert. Everything except for Florida, and he had to do to several things. First off, if he did have a new site that he settled, he had to build a building there and occupy it for a year. And so he was given a letters patent for 7 years. This was a common thing back then. And Dee was the mastermind of this whole process. So he was so appreciative, Gilbert was, of Dee. He gives Dee all the lands north of the 50-degree line. That's all of Alaska, that's all of Canada, and all of Greenland went to John Dee, and Gilbert got all of the rest except for Florida and the Caribbean. They didn't want to mess with Spain down here. these guys think big. You know, I like a guy that thinks big. This guy certainly did. So Gilbert was having some trouble getting the financing for it. So Walsingham came up with an idea. At the time, the Catholics were being persecuted in England, and some of them were taking all their money and moving overseas. And so and the rest of them were recusants. They were thrown into jail. If you didn't attend the Church of England, you were fined £20 a month. And if you didn't pay, your landlord had to pay. So all of these wealthy Catholics were in jail. So Walsingham goes to this guy, Sir George Peckham, a Catholic sympathizer, and he says, if you fund Sir Humphrey Gilbert's expedition, all the Catholics that settled in that first colony in the New World can have complete freedom of religion, freedom to worship as you please. Catholic, it doesn't matter. Now, you might say, this sounds weird, Jim. You're making this all up. Look at you wearing costumes and the whole thing. No. This is all in a book by David Beers Quinn, the most noted authority on Elizabethan exploration. He writes all about it. Because in 1935, someone found this deed in the Elizabethan state papers between Sir George Humphrey Gilbert and Sir George Peckham in 1583. And it says, I deed you all that river port called by Master John Dee, the Dee River, which by the description of Verrazano lies at 42 degrees, mouth open to the south, a half a league wide, and then it goes northeast for 12 leagues, makes a bay 20 leagues in circumference, in which there are five small islands. Well, that's a perfect description of Narragansett Bay. It's the only bay that has that in the side. Verrazano came here from New York. He saw a triangular island. He went north, found this bay. He stayed here for 2 weeks, and he says it has five islands in it. And so here it is, about 42 degrees. That's the latitude, 42. And a mouth open to the south, a half a league broad. Then it goes northeast for 12 leagues. It makes a bay 20 leagues in circumference with its five small islands. So this has been known since 1935. Quinn wrote about it in 1930. And then Samuel Eliot Morison, another great author, he wrote about it, 1970. In 1980, and Morison wrote about it. And nobody in Rhode Island cares. Hey, we don't care. It's early stuff. Anyway, I don't mean to discourage them. I'd like to have them more interested in it. Let me put it that way. So John Dee drew a map in 1580. This is Dee's map. And there is where the triangular island, and there is the bay right there. He shows it right on the map, the John Dee Bay and River. And Dee knew all about Cuba, Jamaica, Haiti, Puerto Rico, Aruba, Curaçao, Bonaire. He was best friends with Gerard Mercator. Look, he's got the Appalachian Mountains. This is 40 years before the Pilgrims came here. He's got the Gulf of St. Lawrence all going all the way down to Montreal. Dee knew all of this stuff. He was way on top of it. So what happened? Sir Humphrey Gilbert set sail in 1583 with five ships from Plymouth, England. One day out, the bark Raleigh got a contagious disease. They had to head back home. The other four ships made it as far as St. John's in Newfoundland. But more people got sick, so they sent the Swallow home. And then you can see, I went up to St. John's, and right there in the middle of town, in this spot, Sir Humphrey Gilbert landed on the fifth day of 1583, took possession of this newfound land in the name of Queen Elizabeth, thereby founding Britain's overseas empire. We only stayed there for 2 weeks to revictualize. This is where he was headed, Newport to the Dee River. But he's very famous up there in Canada. He's one of the founders of Canada. But because, well, I'll tell you what happened was, here he is, a picture of him on a stamp coming into St. John's Harbor in 1583. And there he is commemorated again. Well, they left St. John's, and one of the guys there told him, hey, say you should go to Sable Island. The people put swine and pigs on there, and you'll get all the meat you want. And they had fish for too long. They're like, yeah, we'll go. So they head to this island, Sandy Island, way out in the middle of the Atlantic. A storm comes along. This is the place where the perfect storm was. And the Delight, their biggest supply ship, hits a sandbar, got crushed to pieces. So the other two ships headed back to England off the coast of the Azores. They had another tempest. Sir Humphrey Gilbert's ship gets swallowed up by a huge wave, and he drowns. He never makes it here. He's the guy, and the queen, the land was all in his name, and when he left, the land to title North America becomes void. About a year later, the queen deeded all of North America to his younger half-brother, and that was Sir Walter Raleigh. This was Gilbert's half-brother, and he made three expeditions to Roanoke Island in North Carolina in 1584, 5, and 7. But those were unsuccessful as well, and it wasn't until the Pilgrims came in 1620 that England first made a settlement. Now, here's an interesting thing about Gilbert was got his letters patent on the summer solstice, which was July 11th, because they were still on the Julian calendar, in 1578, and exactly 5 years later to the day is when he departed. These guys did things in accordance with the sun. He departed from Plymouth, England to come here. They wanted to do things just the right way with the sun. Now, Quinn writes about all about this, and he wrote all about, Quinn was a great researcher. He was an Irish guy. He studied in London, and then he went to Madrid, and he said, maybe there's some more there. And he found out that the Spanish ambassador had written letters to King Philip of Spain that talked about, in 1582, Gilbert sent a preliminary expedition of two ships and a pinnace, a small boat that could be rowed or sailed to shore, to the New World as a preliminary expedition under the leadership of Anthony Brigham. And they stayed here for 9 months. And it's not known what they did, because this was kind of a secret mission, but he did return, and he spoke to Walsingham about the discovery of America. And there he is, down at the bottom, there's this Anthony Brigham, 1582, in this book written by Richard Hakluyt, who was a great promoter of American stuff. And there he is, down at the bottom, Anthony Brigham. I claim they came here, these two ships, and built this city tower to be the city center of this first Elizabethan colony, so it would be ready when Sir Humphrey Gilbert came the following year. Well, Sir Humphrey never came. The building got abandoned, and I claim the whole colonization effort and the architect of the building was John Dee. He's the man that put the whole thing together. So thus endeth the second lesson. And we'll go to number three here, this thrilling show. Are you all hanging in with me with it there?
Just a quick question there. It's so fun. We're loving it. But is the word Narragansett Narragansett or something? Never. The name seems intriguing.
Narragansett is the name of the largest Indian tribe in New England, and they had settled on the west coast of this beautiful bay here. And Narragansett means little island, the people of the little island. And they saw themselves as a little island within all of the other tribes of New England. And they grew to be the most prosperous Native American nation in the New World before the Englishmen came over and ruined everything. And they finally got wiped out. Well, not entirely wiped out. They still exist today. Primarily in the Indian Wars in the 1670s, we lost a lot of them.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's okay. Yeah, if you have any questions, because I'm familiar with local lore that people might not be. So John Dee, he cites Vitruvius, the great Roman architect who in 25 BC wrote 10 books on architecture. When they found his books in the Renaissance, Poggio Bracciolini from Italy in 1414 found them, and they translated them, and it changed the course of architecture. Well, Dee writes, an architect's work must be based solidly on the principles of geometry, arithmetic, optics, music, astronomy, cosmography, indeed, all the mathematical arts. By optics, I mean the lights of heaven are well led in the buildings from certain quarters of the world. Well, that's exactly what Penhallow found in this building, the lights from the sun and moon. There's actually two other alignments, the equinox one, and there's a North Star alignment. They go right through the building. There's a guy that's talking about it. He says, as for astronomy, you have to know the directions and the equinoxes and the solstices. Anyone who lacks knowledge of these matters will be unable to understand horology, the art of keeping time. And he says, when I was young, I invented horizontal dials and mural dials and equinoctial dials so you can determine the sun at any given hour. As long as the sun is shining, you can determine the sine and degree ascendant. And he says, but sometimes you can't see the sun, moon, and stars. So industrious mechanics used a way to keep track of time using the flow of water. This is water clocks. And then Ctesibius invented. And then running sand and hourglasses. And then gears and weights. And now springs in the Renaissance. They invented little watches. But all of these methods require correction over time because the inaccuracy of their own operation. Well, how would they correct these types of clocks? He says, there remains among the philosophers a more excellent, commodious, marvelous way than all of these to imitate the motion of the skies, the prime avant, by using nature and art, which you shall understand more of by further search and weightier studies. And he calls it a perpetual motion. Well, he's talking about the camera obscura solidus calendarum. What does he just say? Make a dark room, put a hole in it, and down at the bottom, you keep track, and you'll have not only the time of day, but the day of the year, depending on where it is. You'll have a full calendar. Why doesn't he say that? Because along with the image of the solar disk, you also have an image of everything that's outside. And if Dee, over in his beautiful studio, had people walking across the walls, and horses, and horse tracks, and leaves fluttering, and birds flying, they'd brand him a conjurer. He'd be out of here. As fast as he could say it. So he had to write cryptically about it. That's why you don't hear too much about this camera obscura. You sort of have to read between the lines of what he's saying. And, well, he says them in little riddles. I look like an Amish farmer here. Okay, so in little riddle says, he says, won't the astronomer regret his sleepless nights that he suffered under his cold roof, own roof, with windows and doors shut on all sides at any given time? He will be able to observe the movements of the heavenly bodies, and indeed, without any mechanical instruments made from wood or brass. That's a riddle about the camera obscura. And he calls it, the art of painting, Dee calls zoography, which you'll see. And he says in that is an art called ophthalmazat. Well, thalamos in Greek means Latin, in Greek means chamber, like camera. And so that's his term, ophthalmazat, for the camera obscura. In the Propadumata Aphoristica, which Dee wrote in 1558, in one of his aphorisms, he says, observe and contemplate the wonders of the many fracturings of the heavenly rays in the air, clouds, and water, and you'll be told to praise the infinite wisdom of God. Well, that's fiery water right there, the rays off of the water, and that's also the scintillation that you're talking about, Dad. That is something Dee was very fascinated by. Now, in Europe at the time, in Italy, they'd been using these camera obscura rooms to prove to the Pope that the calendar was off. In these giant cathedrals, this is Santa Maria degli Angeli, they put an aperture up at the top and down at the bottom a noon line, a meridian line. You can still visit this today. This is my picture. And they were in a bunch of, this is the one that's in Bologna. And these were all retrofitted. You can see the chapels were already built. This one, they barely made it between those two posts there. And by watching where the sun crosses, there's the, each day is enumerated. It's a bronze line. And they watch where the solar disk, the image of the sun, fell and crossed that line every day. And by watching where it happened on the summer solstice, on the equinox, and on the winter solstice, and counting the number of days, they were able to prove to Pope Gregory XIII that the Julian calendar was out of sync from the sun by 10 days, leading to the Gregorian calendar reform of 1583. That's the calendar that we still use today. There they are. There's also one in the Tower of the Winds in the Vatican, one of these camera obscura solar discs still there today. Well, in England, Queen didn't know what to do. She'd been excommunicated by the Pope. She needed advice. Who does she turn to? Her wisest philosopher, John Dee. John Dee writes a 60-page treatise on the reform of the calendar, in which he says, yeah, we should change by 10 days. He says, you can tell from these camera obscura rooms we're off. So he draws this thing as part of this thing called the circle of time. And down at the bottom at 6 o'clock, he has Adam, Noah, Abraham, the sons of Israel. This is the Olympic Games, Jesus Christ, Mohammed, Al-Kindi, all the world's greatest hits. The very last one down at the bottom here, he says, Queen Elizabeth, the reformer of the year for the next Christian epic, and that's to begin in 1583, the exact same year I say the tower was built. So this tower not only represents the birth of this new time, but also the beginning of the British Empire. Dee writes, Elizabeth, our Empress Bright, who in the year of 83 thus made truth come to light and civil year with heaven agree. So in 1582, John Dee was on top of the world. He says, I've solved the problem of I got the new time coming in, and new religious freedom is going to happen in the new world with the Catholics. I've really solved this issue. The following year, he was bummed out. Sir Humphrey Gilbert drowned. The colony failed. And the head of the English church says, you know, if this is something the Pope wants to do, we don't want to do that. Archbishop Grindal, and he says, well, we're not going to do it. And he vetoes it. And the English calendar wasn't changed for another 169 years. It wasn't until 1752 that they finally made the change. So that means that Dee was 169 years ahead of his time. So Dee gets so pissed off at his countrymen, he gets on a boat, and he leaps. He takes off. He goes to Europe and spends the next 8 years in the courts of various kings and princes throughout northern Europe. Well, he had other reasons for leaving as well, but I want to get to his main work, the Monas Hieroglyphica. Of all of his books, this is the one that he cherished the most. He dedicated it to Maximilian, the head of all of northern Europe. And when the queen saw it, she said, you must explain this to me, John. And he spends a whole day explaining it to Queen Elizabeth. And when he goes to Prague, he explains it to Emperor Rudolf, who was into alchemy and all of this stuff. And the main thrust of his book is his Monas symbol, the Monas Hieroglyphica symbol. And he says it's very specific about how you have to create it. He says there's a moon half circle, and then on the top is a solar circle with one dot in the center. And then you have this transverse cross, which he calls the cross of the elements, fire, air, earth, and water. And then the symbol for Aries down at the bottom, which, of course, is when the fire happens in the fireplace. At the very end of his book, Dee has this chart called Thus the World Was Created, Sic Factus Est Mundus. And down at the bottom, at the top, he has the supercelestial area. This is the above part. And then down below, the terrestrial and etheric celestial, the below part. Well, look, up here he's got 1 through 8. Down here he's got 1 through 7. Here's the Monas symbol upside down and backwards. He's got various quaternaries, fire, air, earth, and water, 1 through 1,000. 1, 2, 3, 2, and then black, clear, yellow, red, alchemical steps, 12, 13, 24, 25. And then this saying up here in the horizon of eternity. No one's been able to figure out his chart or his book for the last 450 years. I'm like, someone's going to be able to figure it out. So I got a copy of his book. I got all of his translations. And I was able to discern by what I did was I got the copy of his book, which is at the Library of Congress. And it's written in Latin. So I hired a Latin translator. And we went through sentence by sentence, word by word. And I made my own fresh translation of it. And by doing my own fresh translation, I was able to figure out what John Dee was talking about and what the book means and what this whole chart just became totally clear to me. And I mean, it must mean something. This is one of the greatest thinkers of the 1500s. And it's his greatest book. It must be important. So hello. Look, he's got the Monas symbol upside down and backwards. Anyway, it all has to do with it expresses his cosmology, which is a mathematical cosmology. At the end of the book, just before that chart, he has another chart that says, "Thus the world was." This is the chart that says that there are various fixed limits, limitibus statisque, in number. Here's the chart in here. You see they're right on the same spread here in the book. But this book, this one here, has three things, virtus, pondera, and tempora, virtue, weight, and time. And down at the bottom, he calls this magisterial number, the master number, lapidification fermentation, means the philosopher's stone of number is 252. If I could figure out what he means by 252, I'll figure out the whole book. Well, you know, I tried to figure it, and other people have thought about it and tried to figure it out. No one's been able to figure it out. And so, there have been other translations of Dee's books and people trying to figure out, and most people just throw up their hands and like, oh, this is an alchemy book that he threw in some math. No, I saw that it was a mathematics text in which he wrote in alchemical language. But I had a tool to figure out 252 that people didn't have in the 1800s and 1900s. Guess what tool I used? Abacus, slide rule, and calculator, camera obscura. Nope. You know, I figured it out. I Googled it. Yes, I Googled 252. And when I Googled 252, guess who shows up? Buckminster Fuller, one of the greatest thinkers of the 20th century. So I started reading about Buckminster Fuller, and he wrote these two books called Synergetics just before he died, in which he synthesized everything that he found out about in life. The first one was 800 pages, and he said that's not enough. He added another 600 pages with Synergetics 2. Very hard to read, but there's a woman by the name of Amy Edmonds, and she wrote a book, Amy Edmondson. She studied with him at MIT, and she wrote a fuller explanation. Read her first, and then you'll be able to understand Bucky. Anyways, what Bucky found out about geometry and number was the exact same thing John Dee did. And this, to make bring you right to the conclusion, is what I think the tower originally looked like. It had these beautiful, this is all plastered over. You can still see the remnants of some of the plaster today in a technique called sgraffito, which means you plaster something over and then faux paint it to make it look like marble or brick or stone. You used all over the Renaissance. And then on these shelves here, I think there was an entablature, and these arches weren't even meant to be seen. They're merely structural. Above that would be pilasters held on with metal cramp irons and of the Corinthian order, because Dee loved the Corinthian, it was the best. And then another entablature, and then a dome, with a finial on top of it. And the whole thing was of the sacred proportions that include 1 to 2, 2 to 3, and 3 to 4 that Dee knew about. So in other words, all of the structure was made up out of stone, including the dome, and these pieces were added on, and the whole thing was painted, and from a distance, you couldn't tell what it was. And so what it was built on was what I call the two-circle design. Dee calls it the sun and the moon, the two great opposites, 24 by 24. So this is 24 wide and 48 tall with a 6-foot finial on top. So some of the pictures aren't showing up here, but we're getting the gist of it. And in the tower, I claim, were three camera obscura rooms. The first floor room for the sunset, it looked faces west, so the image would be projected onto the fireplace inside. The second floor room, I think, was for the sunrise. And the dome room would be for the middle of the day. I'll tell you just a little bit about the second floor room. It no longer exists, so I can't prove it. But the reason that those two flues that come up here exit off the exterior right about here was because they made smoke. And when you looked out, if you were in the camera obscura room at dawn and you had a fire going, the smoke would appear backlit in front of the rising sun. And inside the second floor room, you have a display of air and earth. And in the first floor room, you have a display of fire and water. Fire, water, and are the four elements right there. And up at the top floor was the dome room. And on the floor would be, we're missing some numbers here, but in the summer, the sun would go across here. On the equinox, it would go through here. And on the winter, it would go through here. And the numbers here should be here. They're not 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock. This is noon, the meridianal line. 1, 2, 3. A giant clock tells you the time of day and the day of the year. In other words, this had three camera obscura rooms, and this is my drawing, my cutaway view of it. And on the top floor would have been this camera obscura room on the floor. So this is what the tower looked like today. It's 28 feet tall, and I claim that it was originally 48 feet tall, and that picture is not showing. But anyways, to explain the whole thing, because I get so excited about it, I wrote these 8 books, and I couldn't get anyone to read my 8 books, so I summarized it in one book that I call Elizabethan America that I sell for $40 on the web. This summarizes basically all of this stuff. I'm not here to sell books. I'm just telling you, if you want to learn more, you're welcome to it, because I don't think that the people are going to get my work while I'm here on Earth, but people someday will. And so, since then, I've written other books. So I've written a total of 20 books on the subject because I find it totally fascinating. And I think it's a very important thing. You can go to Newport Tower Museum, type that in. You can go to my website or my Facebook page. I'm not trying to advertise all of that. I'm just saying if you want to learn more. So that thus endeth the third lesson here. Let's go to number 4. Any questions there, Dan?
No, I think it's so beautifully integrated. I think it had to do the lost images or the way the PDF got converted. I'm sorry about that.
That's okay. I'll explain it. We haven't lost anything very important so far, so I'll make it work. So I go to Buckminster Fuller. I read all of his books, and I become a member of the Buckminster Fuller Institute. And Bucky designed not just geodesic domes, which he's most famous for, but he also designed a three-wheeled car, homes, and his special map that he did, and all of his domes. Here we are at Walt Disney World in Florida, Epcot Center, this giant domes he called Spaceship Earth. And so these are the two books that he wrote, Synergetics. And this is my summary of it. And what the Monas has to do with regards to geometry. Bucky was mostly the geometry guy on it. So basically, if you take one sphere, very simple, 6 spheres fit perfectly around it. Not 5, not 4, exactly 6, perfectly 6. And now if you have one sphere, there are 6 fit around that. But in 3 dimensions, that makes, you get, the 12 fit exactly around one. It's this shape here. And this shape makes the shape of, in other words, in the center, there are 6 around one, and then 3 nesting on the top, and then 3 nesting the opposite way on the bottom. And there's one in the center. So 12 around one makes 13, is another way to look at it here. And that makes the cube octahedral shape, or as Bucky calls it, the vector equilibrium. And a vector is either just means a line that connects 2 points. So this, all of the vectors, the radiating vectors and the edge vectors are totally equal in here. Here's an easier way to look at it. I've rotated a little bit. You see the triangular face and the square face of the cube octahedron, which can be made by intersection of a cube and octahedron. And then here is the 6 right. Here's the triangular face, and there are square faces. So this is how nature grows. Here is a closer effect. Bucky did not like calling it a cube octahedron. He called it, and he even made a logo. This logo is Bucky's design because all the vectors are equal in it. The radiating vectors are equal to the edge length vectors. That's because it's all made out of tetrahedra. Now, here you can see how if you connect all of the center points of all of these points, that's how it makes this shape. And here's a better dynamic view of it. And the 5 platonic solids, as you guys all know, tetrahedron, octahedron, cube, and dodecahedron. But this is one of the first of the Archimedean solids, the cube octahedron here. And but there's 13 of these, and there's 5 of these. But out of all 18, the cube octahedron is the only one in which the length of the edge vector equals the length of the radiating vector. There it is, 1-0. All the others, the radiating vector has to be a little shorter or a little larger. So in other words, I make my models, all I have to do is buy 4-inch lollipop sticks, I can make the whole thing. Here you see how it's an intersection of an octahedron and a cube. If you cut off all the pointy stellations, all you remained, and here I've rotated it, the triangular and square faces of the cube octahedron. Now, if you have one sphere, exactly 12 fit around it, how many fit in the next layer? Well, there's 42 in the second layer of closest packing spheres, and you see it always makes this triangular face and square face. And so Bucky says, if you just have one sphere, it's not really a nucleus. Even when it's in the 12, it's not a nucleus. But when you get the second layer, that 42, that becomes a true nucleus in the center. He calls it the 55-sphere cluster to get a true nucleus. Well, the following year, so here we have 12, 42, and then after that, there's 92 in the next layer, and then the next layer is 162 spheres in it. And the next layer, oh, this is not showing here, but basically what he's saying is that Leonard Euler says the formula for it, which unfortunately isn't showing here, is 10 times the layer squared plus 2. So the layer number, let's take layer 5. 5 squared would be 25 times 10, that's 250. Add 2, and you'll get the fifth layer of the closest packing of spheres, and that is 252 spheres. D's number. There's D's number, what he's sort of talking about. So D was aware of this. Now, what's important about this number, 252, is that when you get to this layer, there are 8 new 55 sphere clusters that have been grown just inside each one of the triangular faces, and there are 8 new nuclei. So 252 is the stage of great birth, and this idea of 8-ness is very important. There's here, in other words, there's 8 tip-to-tip tetrahedra in it, and that's a very important thing, which I'll explain in a second. Now, when D writes in his book, because he writes sort of cryptically, he says, they have seen that the surfaces of elements which are in close proximity are coordinated, connected, and joined together by a law decreed by God Almighty and bond, practically unable to be loosened, of nature. He's talking about how spheres are close pack. And if you read the Monas Hieroglyphica, in it he has this parable from Aesop, in which he talks about this scarab, and he deposits his dung balls, which are round, in with the eggs that the eagle had put in Jupiter's lap. I won't get into the whole thing, but it's all about closest packing the spheres. It's all a riddle. And so what Dee found out in the 1500s was the same thing that Bucky found out. Now, Bucky says he would give lectures all around the globe, and he would say a six-sided figure does not hold its shape. He says a five-sided figure does not hold its shape. And even a four-sided square does not hold its shape. It's just movable. The only one to hold a shape is a triangle, perfectly rigid in all dimensions. And so he says in 3 dimensions, the simplest shape is the tetrahedron. Well, this is nothing new. Plato knew about this. Now, this is not a pyramid of Giza. That has a square base. This is 4 triangular places. But Bucky says you can't have an energy event with just one thing. In order to have an energy event, you have to have 2 tip-to-tip tetrahedra, and they have to be oriented so that these lines go straight through each other. And I'll show you a drawing of that here. In other words, the front edge becomes the back, the left becomes the right. All these lines are continuations of each other. So if you have an upright triangle on one side, the other side is an inverted triangle. So everything is upside down. In fact, you might notice the Star of David going on here, if I can stretch it right. So this is which was fire and water and meeting each other in alchemical language. So I call this a Bucky bow tie, because Bucky liked to wear bow ties. But Bucky says, no. Think of this as an energy event, and think of the 2 tip-to-tip tetrahedra as collapsing down to the center. And when they get to the center, they get to the point of vanishment, and then they come out the other side. Well, if you take 4 pairs of these 2 tip-to-tip tetrahedra, or Bucky bow ties, 2, and there's actually 2 more you need, you make a cube octahedron. That's how it's all made. The Bucky bow tie, 4 of them, form a cube octahedron. Those are all the triangular faces, and the square faces are what's in the middle of it. So he says that there's 8 tetrahedra and the center point is 9. He calls that the null 9, Bucky calls it. And he says this all associates with number. Now, unfortunately, that doesn't show up there, but Bucky associated with this, which I'll have to describe it to you because this is not showing up here, with a thing called called casting out of nines. It's a way to check your arithmetic. And what you do is it involves indigging. You take any addition, subtraction, multiplication problem, and you indig, which means boiling the numbers down to one digit. For example, 27 would indig to 9, or 15 would indig to 6. And so you boil it down to one number. And so you indig the numbers that you are multiplying together, add them all up, and then down at the bottom, the product, the final thing that you have here, which is not showing, you indig that, and if the numbers that you've boiled down the top part to equal to what you boil the bottom part to, then you've done your math correctly. It's a way of checking your mathematics. It's been known since 200 AD, and Fibonacci talks about it. Well, anyway, Bucky says that if you get a 9, the 9 becomes a 0. In other words, in this thing, he says nucleus is like the 9, the nothing. In Latin, none. In English, none. German, nein. French, neuf, nothing. Or interval integrity. He says that's the closest thing we will ever know to. So this one isn't appearing either. But I'll have to. But Bucky basically says that there's this rhythm in number that goes a plus 4, minus 4, and then a null 9. Plus 4, minus 4, null 9. Plus 4, minus. And this rhythm goes on forever. He says, indig congruences demonstrate that 9 is 0 and that number system is inherently octave with an internal rhythm of 4 positive and 4 negative. And he calls it the plus 4 minus 4 rhythm of number. And he says that's the same thing in number that I saw in geometry, where you have 4 pairs of tip-to-tip tetrahedra and the center point is the null 9. He saw that geometry and arithmetic were associated. Well, that's what Dee saw. In his 1570 preface to Euclid, he says that there are all of these sciences, and he lists 14 sciences, but there's only 2 principal ones, arithmetic and geometry. He saw that everything was mathematical to John Dee, and he calls in his chart, here you see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and then horizon eternitas, that means the null 9, that's my writing in there, and my circles around here. In other words, the Greeks called 9 the horizon number because it's on the horizon before all the double-digit numbers. So Dee's mathematics was the exact same thing that Bucky's had discovered in the 1900s. Well, how did I know that Dee knew about the cube octahedron? Because he doesn't really discuss about it in the Monas Hieroglyphica. Well, in his preface to Euclid, which is done in 1570, this is the front cover of it, which he helped translate this great the greatest geometry book ever written, and he introduced all these Englishmen to Euclidean geometry. Dee wrote a very fruitful preface in the beginning of it, and at the very end he added a treatise by a guy by the name of Flossus, who was a great geometer in France. He was the Comte de Candide, and Flossus talks all about the cube octahedron. He doesn't call it that. He calls it an exoctahedron. Now, exo means 6. Exo, sex, 6, 6. That means cube. A 6-sided figure is a cube, and an octahedron, the combination of them, makes this shape that he says has 6 squares and 6 and 8 equilateral 6 equal squares and 8 equilateral triangles. And so he even shows how to make it by making a cube and then cutting off all of the corners where it's the intersection of the cube and an octahedron. So these guys both found the same things, and I'm like, hey. If these guys both found the same thing in life in 2 different centuries, and they're the smartest mofos in each of the centuries, this has got to be important stuff. So basically, it all goes down to the idea of this union of opposites. And Bucky writes in his book, unity is plural, and at minimum 2. Well, that sounds silly. Well, the United States was like one unit. Unity, we usually think of as one. But Bucky always saw that it was 2. In fact, he even writes, he says, well, you think about a sphere. You might think it's one sphere, but I don't see it that way. He says there's an inside and an outside. It's convex and it's also concave. It's like if you're walking on the earth, you think that the earth is convex because you were walking on top of it. But to an earthworm or a fish, it's concave, because they see the top of the earth is different. So he always saw two things, and he saw, if you see one stick or one line, we see it as one stick, one lollipop stick. Bucky didn't see it that way. He saw that as the connection between two places. In other words, he says it's like two spheres connected in between, which is like this same two-circle design that I'm talking about in the tower. Bucky summarizes it in the very succinct way. He says, unity equals two. And so he always saw that this idea of union of opposites was in everything. And this is what Dee says in his Monos Hieroglyphica, the light of the philosophers was made the day the sun and the moon were joined. He says, the sun and the moon subtend the same angle. He says, when it's a full moon, it's the same size as the sun. And it's true. They each subtend an arc of 0.5 degree, even though one is 93 million miles away and almost 24, and they're different sizes and proportions. They both appear the same to the human eye. So this is the idea of union of opposites, the sun and the moon, the two opposites. It's just basically your yin-yang thing. And so these guys both found out the same thing, and both use the same psychology in different eras. So thus ends the fourth sermon. If you have any questions, I will take them. I will give you a minute to go to the bathroom. But then we're going to start with session number 5, so don't tarry, because session 5 is just as exciting. It's called, let me get to it here.
Dee's rare gift to King Maximilian.
So take a little break if you want. If you have any questions, put them on the side.
James, we're having an audio problem. Right now we're getting some audio static.
Okay, hold on a second.
Just to mention to folks there that the beautiful PDF files that James supplied for this course, all the graphics are present. If you download the PDFs at fractalu.com, the missing slides are present. The glitch apparently is the way that Learnit Live converted the PDFs to the slideshow here, so I apologize to folks for that. But the completed PDF graphics, all 8 of them, with all the slides present, are at fractalu.com. And maybe we'll get James to do another sound test here so he can fix this little sound glitch.
Yeah, we really didn't miss too much in there. A little bit of the mathematics. Hopefully the rest of the slideshow will work very nicely.
The sound is better now. That's good. And I did mention that the PDFs that you sent have all the slides present, and they're at fractalu.com, so people can see them.
Good. So here's my models. I made these out of just lollipop sticks. This one here is doesn't have the radiating vectors. You see the squares and the triangles. This one has the radiating vectors in it, and it's pretty solid. And if you take a bunch of these and add them together, you've got what's called space frame, which is the strongest material using the strongest structure using the least amount of material. Here's another one that has the triangular faces that are black and gray. And of course, then there's the Bucky's famous jitterbug here, which is basically his cube octahedron. And he says that in it that you got the square faces. But if you take a square face and if you were to compress it and put a diagonal in the square face here, when you compress it just a little bit, you get what's called an icosahedron, the 20 triangles. And then if you press it a little bit further, you get the octahedron, which is another one of the Platonic solids. And then if you compress it and twist it, you get the basic building block of universe, tetrahedron. And so this whole thing is basically found within this shape, which makes it a very special thing. And I think Dee knew about this, and Bucky knew about it. And so Bucky says, I was searching for nature's operating system. And Dee says, I was searching for true knowledge of God's laws and ordinance. And they both found the same thing. I'm like, well, I don't have to be smart enough to figure that out. So let's start with what Dee's rare gift was for King Maximilian. So Dee,
I just wanted to say, James, it was one of the high points of my life was when I spent a week with Bucky Fuller and he showed me all that personally.
Wow, in Florida.
Yes, exactly. Yes.
Nice. He's the man. He's the inspiration. Yeah. And so, so I see he continues to amaze me. So, these guys both found the same thing, but there was another guy by the name of Robert Marshall when I started Googling 252, and he came up, and he was a mathematician in California, and so I corresponded with him for 10 years. He taught me everything he knew, and he knew all about 252, much more than even Bucky knew about. And so he wrote to Bucky in 1982 and said, Bucky, I found something that I think would be of great interest to you. And Bucky was so excited about Marshall's work, he says, your work fills me with joy. Would you be willing to publish it in another edition of Synergetics, a third book, with full credit to you? They started working on it. Bucky died. No one is able to understand Marshall because it was kind of Bucky's stuff. And so, as I said, we corresponded for 10 years. And then a year and a half ago, Marshall died. I'm the only one that knows. Well, that's why I'm sharing it with you. Anyways, I wrote this book about it called Monus Hieroglyphica with regards to number that explains all about Marshall and the whole thing. Marshall had a different mind than numbers. He was not like an academic mathematics teacher. He wasn't. In fact, he didn't even go to college, but he had a mind for number patterns. He says, when I was young, I could not get 5 minus 2, but it didn't make any sense to him. But when he saw numbers, when he saw dots and you take away dots, then it was important for him. So he developed this this system of understanding numbers based on, well, Marshall was a hippie. He lived in the Haight-Ashbury in 67, Summer of Love. And a guru came to town, and he went to the guru and said, I have this mind for numbers. I keep figuring numbers. What should I study? And the guru says, study the number 108, sacred number of the Hindus. So Marshall made what he calls the his 108 bricks in the fireplace, 108 verses in the Rig Veda, 108 is in the calendar system, 108 beads in the mala. And so it's very sacred number that goes all the way back to early Hindu. And, you know, early Hindus, they're the ones that figured out the numbers. They came to the Arabics, and then we got it from the Arabics. So we're talking way back there. Well, Marshall worked in the machine shop, and he figured out how to make a circular dial that had the numbers. Now, you can't see it here, but basically he starts down at the bottom with 1, and he goes all the way up to 108, and then around again in the next layer to 214, and then to 324, and he went out 64 times. And then he started studying the rhythms in it. You see these little lines right here. Marshall studied all these rhythms, and that's how he was able to discern all of these things. And he says, number is a two-way street. That doesn't sound right. We all know 1, 2, 3, 4. Well, you don't back. He's not talking negative numbers. He's saying that all the positive integers have the, I'll explain what that means in a second. And he says, at certain finite limits, there is complete symmetry of number. I'll show you that as well. And he says, 1 is not a number. Well, that sounds silly to us. We learned all in kindergarten, 1, 2, 3, 4. Well, up until the 1700s, nobody thought 1 was a number. D didn't think 1 was a number. In fact, he even says, although a unit be no number, and even Aristotle, they all talk about it. They saw 1 as the fount of all numbers. Numbers started with 2. 1 included all the other numbers. They didn't consider as 1. This is a different way that we look at it today. Anyway, Marshall came up with this idea of retrosity. When he invented this symbol to show it. And it's basically the idea of opposites, that's the opposites, and equal. It's a thing that's both opposite yet equal. It's very simple. Here's my interpretation of it. The blacks on one side are opposites the white. And he says, if you take the number 29, the opposite is 92. The opposite 341. You just take a number and flip it over. Very simple. And certain numbers are palindromic. The opposite of 270 would be 72. The opposite 2700. Some numbers have several transpalindromic mates, but it's just basically you take the opposites. He says it's like hot is the opposite of cold. They're opposites, but they're both equal. They're both just temperature. And loud and quiet, they're both just degrees of sound. So he says when you apply this to number, by the way, that's what this is in geometry, only Marshall says apply it to number and you'll see some very interesting things. Here's an example of this fun retrosity on your calculator. You take 1 and divide it by 49. You get this number 02, 04, 08, 16, 32, 64. These are all in multiples of 2. There's something's going on here, but that's not a key thing in Marshall. Here's the key thing. You take this chart of the single and double digit numbers. It goes from 1 up to 99. You learned this in the sixth grade. It's a very simple chart. And then you flip it over backwards, like you're reading Hebrew or Chinese. I haven't really changed anything here. Now you take this chart and take the top of it and just tilt it over 45 degrees, and you get this chart here. Now look, down the middle is the spine. Everything on this side has a perfect reflection on the other side. Here's another way of showing it here, like 15, 51, 27, 72, 48, 84. Here's a better way to look at it. Complete symmetry of number. Isn't that a beautiful thing? Everything on this side is perfectly reflected on the other side. And right down the middle are all the two-digit palindromic numbers, 11, 22, 44, and so forth. We call this the 11 wave. They're all the only palindromic numbers there are in the two-digit range. They happen to be in the middle. So it looks like this wave rules the chart, but it doesn't. It's ruled in conjunction with the 9 wave that goes across the center here. Now, the 9 wave is 18, 27, 36, 45, 54. These are all opposites as well. There we go. 18 is the opposite of 81, 27, 72, 36, 54, and so forth. And so it's both of these things, the 9 and the 11 wave, that make the chart, and of course, they multiply to 99. Now, the 9 wave, as I showed, 18, 81, and so forth, that's the in the double-digit range. When you get to the three-digit range of numbers, it's the basic key things here is that 9 is the number that works with transpalindromes, and 11 is the palindromizing number. And 10, of course, is our base number right in the middle. And, of course, they multiply to 99. In the three-digit range, it's called the 99 wave, this idea of backness and forthness, 198, 891, 297, 92. In other words, these are all the multiples of 99, 98 and times 3, times 4, and you get this rhythm that has this oppositeness to it, and then there's always the null ninth thing. This one here is the null nine. That's the rhythm, plus 4, minus 4, null nine, that Bucky was talking about. And this is what Marshall meant by number is a two-way street. On this three-digit range, you see the numbers going this way are the exact opposites of the numbers going this way. He saw numbers as a balance, as a symmetry, not just a single destination. Now, if you multiply 11 times 99, you get this number 1089. Now, that number is the number that of the wave for the four-digit range of numbers. In other words, this is 1089 times 2 times 3 times 4. So that times 9 is the opposite of 9801, and then you get this whole rhythm, and this is the null number for the next. And so, but the middle this nave is formed, 5445, and because of that, the next wave is the 10890 wave, and then the 10890 wave, and then the 10900 wave, and it goes on forever. So this is what Marshall calls the cycloflex. As you cycle through numbers, numbers flex back on themselves. Well, D calls this the consummata in his book. D used a different thing, but that's exactly what D had figured out, and that's where you see the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 in his Thus the World Was Created chart that I showed before. So that was number 5. Let's go to 6 here. And besides the cycloflex, Marshall told me, he says, there's two rhythms of numbers, and the other one is called the holotomic numbers. Holo means whole, and tome means book. So these are whole books of numbers, and this is what D calls the metamorphosis numbers. The recipe is very simple. You take the number 12, and you multiply it times the primes in their consecutive order, 2, 3, 5, 7, and so forth. And let's just stick to the single-digit range right here. So 12 times 2 is 24, times 3 is 72, times 5 is 360, and then times 7 is 2520. There's 252 in there. And then times 11 is, look at this number, 2772. Again, that has oppositeness in it. And then we multiply and times the next prime, which is 13, and we get 360, 360. Look at that, two circles. That's amazing. And then we get 616, 6160. And then when we get into 19 and 23, we're starting to get more complex numbers. But these first holotomics of 12, 24, 72, 360, and 25, 20 are very important numbers. Well, 360, that's numbers in a circle. 72, the 72 angels. 424, this is 12 is months, years, disciples, whatever. 24 hours in a day. These are all very important cosmo numbers. And D saw that. That's what his Monas Hieroglyphic is about. He's like, hey, these numbers are in here. You'll notice that there's 24 theorems in here. Anyway, you'll notice that the opposite of 2520 is 252, John Dee's number, the fifth of the numbers. And this number is also the lowest number possible that you can divide all the single digits into, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. No other number is lower. Now, what Plato said, the ideal city has 540 people in it. That's because they can divide it up into so many different ways. Well, 5040 is 2 times 2520. Plato knew about 2520. He just said, well, that's a little small for a city. Let's double it. We'll be okay. We'll still be able to divide. So Dee knows about all this. Dee's favorite book was The Republic by Plato. So again, this shows the divisions of it. But this 2520 is a very important number. When Dee says he wrote the Monas Hieroglyphica, he says, it took me 7 years to write this. Well, back then, they used to estimate 360 days a year. It's 2,520 days is a clue right there. So I call 108 the sacred number of the East, and D's number the sacred number of the West. Guess what happens if you add them both together? 252, a perfect circle. In other words, these are both expressions of the same rhythms that they see in numbers that the Hindus saw and that Dee saw. And Dee wasn't the only one. There were other fellow by the name of Pantheus who wrote Vorchadumia about gold making. He knew about 252 and he includes it in it. But it wasn't until Marshall kind of pieced this all together that I was able to understand it. And so this 108 is actually 36 times 3, and 252 is 36 times 7. So this 7/10 and 3/10 is a very important thing, but I won't get into all of that stuff. That's further down the line. It has to do with 2520. Now, what they mean by symmetry in number is that if you were to make a wheel out of the numbers, let's take the 12 wheel. Here in the middle, we got 1 through 12, and the next one goes all the way up to 24, to 36, and so forth. So these are all the multiples of 12 up in here. And then we gray out in the dark gray all the prime numbers. We find they only fall in these four rows. And so this chart has complete symmetry across a vertical axis, across a horizontal axis, and in a camera obscura, which is both reverse and upside down. Here is the 24 wheel. All the primes will only fall in these rays right here. It looks like a Maltese cross. But for comparison, here's the 30 wheel. Now, that has symmetry vertically, but it does not have symmetry horizontal or in a camera obscura. That is not a camera. That is not a holotomic number. 30 is not. Here's the 72 wheel. Perfect symmetry of all of the primes, and here I've made it even more graphic to show all of the radians. Here's the 360 wheel. All the primes fall in the gray rows, and the composite numbers fall in the other rows. Perfect symmetry of number. It's a beautiful thing. I couldn't even do the 2520 because it was so intricate. So Marshall calls this the Great Eagle 2520, and you can split the chart in half, and it each has 1620 in it. So here's the chart of the holotomic numbers, 1, and then 12, 24, the fourth one, 2520, and then we get 27720, 360. And now this number here is divisible by all the single digits up to 18, except there's a problem. 16 does not divide, the number 16 does not divide into here. When you do divide it in, you get a number that ends in 0.5. So it kind of not blows the whole thing. But in order to get a number that's divisible by all 18, the numbers up to 18, we have to multiply this number times 2. Well, when you do, here's the number you get. 12,252,250. Look at this number. It's got 12, the first number, first holotome. 252, Dee's number, and it's got 24, the second holotomic number, and a zero. So you could even make 2520 out of this if you put the zero. It's incredible. This is a number in the 12 million range in which the primes and the composite numbers are in perfect symmetrical array. It looks like any of the other charts, only it's whole mungo, 12 million of them. So there it is right there, 2520, way up at the top. That includes all the 18. Here are actually all the multiplications. You can see how it's divisible by all of these numbers. And so he calls this the even greater eagle because it is so much. Well, that's what Dee's rare gift is to Maximilian. Dee says at the very first paragraph, he says, I have a gift for you. It's very small, but it's very important. Well, he's talking about this number here, and he calls it the exemplar number of all things numerable, cryptically in one of his books. So we've got the cycloflex, which is what Dee calls consummata, which is the 9 wave, the 99 wave, 108.9, and so forth. And then we got the holotomic sequence, 12, 24, 72, and they don't seem related at all. One seems sort of additive, one's kind of multiplicative, but they are. They're very interconnected, and I'll just show you one way in which they're connected. We'll take the first three numbers, 12, 24, and 72, find their opposites, 21, 42, and 27, and we'll add these up. Well, this adds up to 33, 24 and 42 adds up to 66, and 72 and 27 add up to 99. These two add up to that number, and 99 is the key number in the cycloflex. It's the bottom of that triangle that I showed you. So we started with holoatomic numbers here, and we ended up with a number that is the key to the cycloflex. That's just one way to show that they're related. Now, the other way that I want to show is that these single digits, the opposite of 4 is 4, 8 is 8, and so forth. The opposite of 11 is 11. That's a palindrome. The first transpalindromic pair we have is 12 and 21, right up here at the middle of the chart, right? You following me? Well, guess what 12 times 21 equals? 252. D's magic number. It's kind of disappeared there, but and it's 252. Trust me, 12 times 20 is 252. So these two numbers multiply to D's magisterial number. Now, in D's chart, the Thus the World is Created chart, at the end of the Monos Hieroglyphica, he says metamorphosis and consummata. That's what these two are. And he gives a little clues. Here's 1881, 2772, 63, 36, 45, 54, with this giant X going through here. And the horizon of eternity, that's number 9. There's the rhythm, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, number 9. D also was he invented the use of colons for proportions. D was the first guy to use colons. You can read about it in the books on mathematical notation. And you'll notice here this colon, 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4. These are the ratios that Pythagoras found out about 1 to 2, 2 to 3, and 3 to 4, the great harmonic ratios. But so basically what Marshall saw in the 1900s was the exact same thing that John Dee saw in the 1500s. And I'm like, if these two smart guys can both find the same thing, well, then it must be important. So thus ends the sixth lesson. We will go on to number 7 here. And I want to make sure I have enough time. We're at 23 past the hour to get my last one, which has to do with Shakespeare, which is very exciting. I haven't really gotten much for all you Shakespearean fans in here. Let's see. Number 7 is I don't see it on the list here. I don't see number 7, unfortunately.
It did get uploaded. It should be there.
Let's see.
Just scroll on the list?
Yeah, I'm only getting 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm not seeing number 7. 7 was...
Is 7 and 8 there?
Here, 8 wait. Is here.
Oh, I'm sure I have 7.
Oh, there's 7. Look, there it is, up at the top. It was way up above the welcome sign. Sorry, everybody. All right, that's good. We get to catch everything. Because this is what you were interested in, what it has to do with optics. Now, Dee says, they use the idea of visual pyramids to describe how light works. And so it all has to do with the art of perspective. Perspectiva is what they called it back then. We call it optics, same thing. Dee says, without understanding perspective, astronomical appearances cannot be easily comprehended. And perspective is the most important of all the sciences, Dee says, because it deals with light, the first of God's creatures, and it deals with the eye, the light of our body, and his sense, most mighty, and his organ, most artificial and geometrical. Artificial means artful. Dee was love the eyeball and how it all works. So when Dee describes in the 1570 preface to Euclid, zography, it means painting from life. Zo means life. Graphy means to paint or to draw. And he defines it as the intersection of visual pyramids. I'll get into this in a second. As I mentioned, he also says there's a certain art that's useful for sculptors, intagliers, curvers, carvers, founders, and painters called althalmazat, and that's the camera obscura that they were just starting to use in camera obscuras. He's showing that they knew about it, and I wrote a whole book that I think Leon Battista Alberti knew about it as well. And as I said, it's althalmazat. The middle thalamus word means tholos, and the tholos is a hut or a house, and it basically a dark chamber. You block this up, you're going to get the camera obscura. On the front cover of his Monos Hieroglyphica, way down at the bottom, you'll see he draws a picture of a tholos in his picture on water. But inside his 1570 description, he says, Zoography is a mathematical art that teaches and demonstrates how the intersection of all visual pyramids made by any plane assigned, the center, distance, and light being determined, may be represented by lines and due proper colors. Well, that's exactly what Alberti had written in a century earlier in his definition of painting in his groundbreaking book on painting. A painting is the intersection of a visual pyramid at a given distance with a fixed center and a defined position of light represented by art with lines and colors on a given surface. He just reworded a little bit. And so what he means by a visual pyramid is you're looking out and you saw a square object and you connected all the corner points. That's the pyramid. Now, pyramid does not necessarily mean three lines. It can be four. So let's envision that Alberti goes for a holiday and in Tuscany, and he sees these different shapes. Well, the three-sided shape, there's going to have three angles. The four-sided shape, it's going to have four. Five sides are going to have five, and the cow is going to have many. But the simplest shape is three. Now, you could say, well, what about a line? Well, if it's a line, if it's a stick, that's actually four things. And if it's a line, you're not seeing anything because you're not into the third dimension. So this triangle, this tetrahedra, is the simplest shape for the visual pyramids. Now, we apply that to a camera obscura room. We turn off the lights, except in one room we leave the light on. The image of what's outside appears on the inside. It's two tip-to-tip tetrahedra. In other words, the minimum description of light in a camera obscura, the most economical description, is Bucky Bowtie, the two tip-to-tip tetrahedra. And Dee knew all about this as well. And in his, in other words, this is exactly how an eye works. And what Alberti knew was that, you know, when we read something, look at something, it's always the central ray. He calls this the prince of rays, which is the most important. And of course, that's what goes to our fovea, which has the most acute vision. Well, we do see peripherally the whole thing, but it's all upside down and backwards. He calls it the intrinsic ray, that one center ray. Well, Dee writes cryptically about it in the Monas Hieroglyphica. He says, won't the astronomer regret his sleepless nights under the open sky when here, without any discomfort from the air, under his own roof, with windows and doors shut on all sides, at any given time, he is able to observe the movements of the heavenly bodies, and indeed, without any mechanical instruments made from wood or brass. That's a riddle about the camera obscura. And Dee writes, I can show you most assuredly by actual experience that the element of earth can float above that of water. Well, if his kids are playing in the mud and the Thames River is off beyond, he lived in Mort Lake on the Thames, inside his studio, his library, the element of earth floats above that of water. It's all a riddle. And he says, it's all written in Latin here. Here a line is presented resulting from a three-cornered tetrahedron from which, when made full circle, a mirror may be found. Well, the mirror is the image in a camera obscura. And so here it is here. You get one tetrahedron. When he says full circle, he means you have both sides of it, making the Bucky bow tie. And he calls this forma circulata. So in other words, the three-quarter section presents a line, that's a center gray. When made full circle, a mirror can be found. That's the magical image in a camera obscura. And it's all based on the Bucky bow tie. Dee adds after this, he says, that even when the sun is being blocked by clouds, in fact, camera obscuras worked on cloudy days, can reduce any kinds of stone or metal into impalpable powders by the force of truly the strongest heat. Well, stone and metal, you see a car or a brick wall outside, it's going to look like powder printed on the image on the interior by the force of truly the very strongest heat. That's just the sun that gives us all of our light. So it's all about a riddle. And his Monas Hieroglyphica, he says the sun and the moon, the two great opposites. And he turns the Monas symbol upside down in his book and uses it metaphorically. But he says it's very important. This shape has to be made exactly these proportions. And he says, goes into, he tips down two pages. If this is A is 1, this is AB is 1, then this is 3, and this is 2. The diameter of this equals the diameter of this, and the diameter of that equals, very important. He goes through all the geometrical proof. But look, out of all the letters, he says A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Look what letter he uses on this thing that looks like a giant cyclops. The letter I. And Dee is making a riddle that his Monas Hieroglyphica is also a model of vision, a cyclops, a thing that sees. And my friends, Peter and Eric, they have a camera obscura they set up every year at the Rhode Island School of Design. And it's a box 8 feet by 8 feet by 8 feet. And in the center, right where the hole is, They put the eyeball. That's the same joke that Dee's talking about here. The image will be upside down. Look out. And then inside, you'll see everything upside down. People come in, and they had Armenio, their friend, draw a painting, and he draws the same joke. A cyclops upside down in a camera obscura. They knew nothing about Dee. They all came to the same place. In Western Massachusetts, this guy makes a corn maze every year. Here's looking down at his house. And he did a cyclops one year, and right where the eye is, he put a camera obscura. It's all the same riddle. It's nothing so unusual about it. It's fun. And the Monas symbol, I claim, is the blueprint for Dee's tower. It's a mathematical harmony. And that's a camera obscura as well, a thing that sees. It's a camera. It's a calendar. And it's a clock. Here you see the light coming through, and you're able to keep track of time and how we saw that it acted like an eye and that it was three different camera obscura rooms. Now, to summarize all of this stuff, it all has to do with the union of opposites, basically yin-yang, if you want to put it that way. So what we're missing some text here, but what Fuller found out about the union of opposites in the bucky bow tie that makes the cube octahedron, and what Marshall found out about the union of opposites in the numbers here, 12, 21 makes 252, but also this butterfly of a chart, and what Penhalla found about the sun and the moon going through the tower, the two great opposites Dee had, and what I found out about the camera obscura, which is the optics of upside downness and yin-yangness, that's what Dee's book is about, his symbol is about, and the tower is about. And he was as smart as all of us combined in the Renaissance. Why? He was an interdisciplinarian, and he wanted to see how the whole world worked. In other words, the book, the symbol, and the tower, architecturally, symbolically, and literally in literature, represent all the same thing, Dee's mathematical cosmology.
Whoa!
Anyways, you see, I get excited about it. Chill me down here. But we're going to on to the seventh. Yeah.
Super. Well said, James. It's so exciting. And please do continue. I just wanted to say that when laser physicists were investigating how opposing lasers phase conjugate, the magic is the phase conjugate mirror high dielectric, which is where the beams actually cross and turn inside out. And that's what they call conjugate and what Dee called to conjure. And the reason is because at that point, the plasma implodes and you create literally a fusion phenomena. And that's where you get all the negentropy and the magic, which is the phase conjugate origin of perception, which is two pine cones kissing noses, which is exactly, as you say, Bucky Fuller's bow tie. It's a beautiful introduction to some very serious phase conjugate optics.
Right. And Dee knew about it back hundreds of years ago. Well, now we have a special guest. Go ahead.
No, you go ahead. Please, go ahead.
Oh, we have a special guest coming for our final eighth lecture. Guess who it is? The bard of Sanford von Avon himself, William Shakespeare. Greetings, everybody. What this book is about, I want to tell you that the synchrony between Shakespeare and John Dee. You know, I say, well, what do they have to do with each other? Well, here's what I tell people. John Dee was 100 times more important in the Elizabethan Renaissance than William Shakespeare was. How can you say that, Jim? We have college apartments totally dedicated to Shakespeare, and nobody ever talks about John Dee. Well, I'll tell you why. Dee was born in 1528. The Queen was born in 1533. They grew up together. They were in jail together under Queen Mary. And when Dee came to the throne, when the Queen came to the throne in 1558, Dee is asked to select the most propitious day for her coronation. He becomes her philosopher. He tells her she has a legal right to all of North America, and in 1564, he writes the Monas Hieroglyphica, and she wants to see it. He explains it to her. 1564 was when Shakespeare was born. So he was a baby. He wasn't famous until 1559, and the queen died in 1603. He was at the tail end of it. He was like some, I'm not saying diminishing the importance of Shakespeare. He was an important guy and he was an incredible writer. But I'm saying Dee was the man in Elizabethan history that really kind of pieced the whole thing together. And so it's like, if Shakespeare came about. Now, even if you don't think Shakespeare was the bard from Avon, if you think maybe he was Edward de Vere, which a lot of people think, even de Vere was born in 1550, I think it was. So he would only been 14 years old when Dee was writing the Monas Hieroglyphica. He was a young guy, too. But the idea here, so I'm not going to get into who was Shakespeare thing, but whoever Shakespeare was, He certainly would have known about Dee, one of the smartest guys, one of the most controversial people. And so when I was in high school, I read a book called The Tempest, you know, the play. And when I started studying all of this other stuff, I'm like, maybe there's something else going on. So I decided to reread the Tempest and figured out what it had to do with this tower, which, as I mentioned, has the sun alignments, the moon alignments, and then I found out about the colonization effort, that this was called the John D. Bay and River, this bay where I actually live in Newport right there. And then the D was the guy that wrote all these books to the Queen, and he drew the picture that talks about send forth a sailing expedition to the New World. Now, at the same time, there was a fellow by the name of Richard Hakluyt, the elder, and his cousin, Richard Hakluyt, same name, and they were great enthusiasts about the colonization effort. They wrote these books trying to promote. It's like, you know, the best thing for England is to expand before Spain gets all of them. It was a no-brainer for them, but they had to convince the people of England. So 1583, we get Sir Humphrey Gilbert, and then he drowned, and then the next year, Sir Walter Raleigh, he comes up, and one of the captains on the ship, his name was Edward Hayes. He was on the five-ship mission with Sir Humphrey Gilbert, and he wrote a report. You can go on the web, Hayes' report, Sir Humphrey Gilbert's mission, and he described the whole journey, even Sir Humphrey Gilbert's death. He was there. He was the one surviving ship that out of the five that made it back to England, and he witnessed Sir Humphrey Gilbert drowning in the Azores. And the other captain of the Delight was a guy by the name of William Winter. His father had been the admiral for England, but this was his son, another very famous sailor. And as I said, he made it to St. John, Sir Humphrey Gilbert did, but then he drowned. He didn't make it here in the whole thing, and he drowned in a tempest. And I'm like, tempest? Hello? That sounds like tempest to me. And remember I told you about the 1582 expedition, and Anthony Brigham was the guy that was here for 9 months, and I claim built the tower and to be the city center of this first Elizabethan colony. And it was to be an Anglican colony where the Catholics could worship as they please. Just want to throw this in there, is that Rhode Island became the center of religious freedom in America in colonial times, and the first governor of Rhode Island owned the tower. So that's a longer story. But the point is, Dee was the guy that puts it all together. And before he went to Europe in 1583, he wrote these over 40 books. He was a great writer himself. Not many people read his stuff. It wasn't all published. But the main book was the Monas Hieroglyphica. And in it, he writes, "The general evaluating rule that the strength of an intrinsic value of the one thing purported by others to be chaos is primarily explained beyond any arithmetical doubt by the number 10. What does he mean by this? He calls 10 the ultimate power of nature's art. Now, Dee saw 10 as a return to 1. You go through the single digits, and 10 was like coming back to 1, and then you get 10, 20, 30, 40, and then 1,000, 2,000. So this is part of a cycle that he saw. And he also called it the iod. Now, in his book, he talks about iod, and some people pronounce this yod, like the Hebrew letter. But he says an iod is made from one straight line and two different parts of the circumference, recta descente, linea una, diversus periferae. Now, what does he mean by that? Well, it's one straight line and two different parts of this. It's exactly what he says. And it looks like the Greek phi or the Hebrew yod is how it's pronounced, the iod. And in Dee's Monas Hieroglyphica, where he's, you know, you can tell Dee is into symbols, he uses this as sort of a cryptic symbol in here. And the idea of tenness can be seen in the Monas, where there are 10 points on the spine, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, there's one there, there are 10 points. So there are 9 spaces or 10 points, very important. And in his first opening theorems of the Monas Hieroglyphica, he says, the first and most simple representation of all things in nature is made by means of a straight line and a circle. And there it is right there. He's got the diameter right there, but you want to put that in there. And that's the iod symbol. It's the simplest thing. He also says the first mystical letters of Hebrew, Greek, and Latin are made from straight lines and circles. What he means here is that he's borrowing from this guy, Geoffrey Torrey, who wrote a book. He was a French guy, and he wrote Champ Fleuri, Field of Flowers. And he says the I and the O are the letters, the line and the circle, from which all the other letters are made. And he's right about the capital Latin letters. And this is from Torrey's book. He says the I and the O makes what he calls this shape, the I-O right here. And so there's what Dee was getting at. This iod shape, this wane shape, works in geometry, where you get a straight line and a circle makes the iod shape. It works in alphabet, the I, the O makes the iod. It works in philosophy, the 1 and the 0, which is nothing, makes the iod shape, or space and void. And then it also works in the number 10. You got a 1 digit and a 0, makes the iod. And look at this. The letter even spells iod. I-O-D has an O, and has it, you can make all the letters out of the shapes that he has here. So D loved this magical type of stuff. And so no one's, as far as I've ever heard, been able to decipher what he meant by iod. That's what I think it meant. 1583, John Dee is asked by the Queen whether she should change the calendar or not. And as I said, he says, yeah, we should change it, but the head of the English church says we don't want to do it. And it was 169 years later they finally adopted it, because they didn't listen to my man Dee. So he sets sail and he goes to Europe. But before he does, Edward Kelly comes knocking on his door, who can read a crystal ball, and they held seances, you all know about, and they talk to Uriel, and they talk to Madimi and the angels. So what my conjecture was that Shakespeare and Dee might have written co-authored this book, both been responsible for it. Well, how do I base that? Where did I start on this? Well, any encyclopedia like the Britannica will tell you, it's almost certain that William Shakespeare modeled the character of Prospero in The Tempest on the career of John Dee, the Elizabethan Magus. I don't think there's one scholar that will disagree that Prospero was based on John Dee. Well, there's a pretty good starting point. The main character is based on my man. So then I started reading it, and I found Gonzalo in the end of first scene of Act 1. Gonzalo writes, and he was the wise friend of the king. Now I would give 1,000 furlongs at sea for an acre of barren land, long heath, brown firs, anything but the wills be done. I would fain die a dry death. That's the exact same thing that Sir Humphrey Gilbert said when he drowned. We are as near to heaven by sea as by land. And their name both starts with a hard G. Gilbert Gonzalo. So I said, well, that's who he probably is. Now, and then this whole idea of the idea of the iod and the strength of one thing was the number 10. The number 10 is like all over this book. And so he says that's the general, this is D's general evaluating rule. There's 10 scenes if you include the epilogue in the book, and which is a very important one where Prospero forgives everybody. There's 10 letters in the name, The Tempest, and the is actually part of the name that Shakespeare had. Now, the other thing is that the word tempestus means a stretch of time. Templum means a stretch of land. Tem means a stretch. But it didn't start off that way. It started off with T-E-N was the word for stretch. But through assimilation, it became tem. What do I mean assimilation? Well, if you have the word tempestus, which it originally was in Latin, if you say it over and over again, it ends up becoming sounding like tempestus through a thing called a phonetic assimilation. In other words, when followed by a P, an M is easier to say than an N. That is two nasal letters, M and N. Those are the only sounds, letters that sound out your nose. Well, M, you make a closed mouth. N is closed tongue. And so P is a plosive. Puh, that's your lips too. So to get from M to P, it's easier than N to P. So as a result, sorry for that graphic there of my funny mouth, the tempest, it used to be the tempest, 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 it became the tempest. So when Dee looks at the word the tempest, he sees the word the tempest. In the title, he sees the 10, which is his special number. Now, how do I know this? Well, Dee wrote in his library catalog, which I own a copy of, he wrote down that he owned several dictionaries. So I found the dictionary that he had. It's called Robert Stephanus's Latin Dictionary. It was the most comprehensive dictionary at the time. That's Dee's writing right there in his book. And so I said, well, let me see what Dee saw. So I went up to Brown University and tried to find, and they had a copy of Stephanus's book from the 1500s. It's actually a three-volume Latin dictionary. And this guy lived before Dee, 1503 to 1559, so he was dead. But I'm like, hey, Stephanus, that's the same name as Stefano. Could it be? I'm like, well, let's investigate. So up at Brown, I got a car. I went right. I was so excited. I got to the Thames and the Tens, and up at the top of the list of the book, it says Tem and Ten. This is the Ten page where the Thames were ending and the Ten was starting. So there's Tem and Ten right at the beginning, but that doesn't prove anything. That's just in the marginalia. So I looked up the word tempestus. And there it is right there, tempestus, adjective, blah, 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 blah. And there underneath it, you start the 10 words very shortly thereafterwards. So there's tempest and there's 10. And you might say, well, that still doesn't prove anything, Jim. Yeah, well, here's the proof. There's only one set of words that are in between. This is tementula, tementula, tementulus, and tementum. And you know what that means? Drunk or intoxicated. That's exactly what Stefano was. This is the riddle that Dee wanted us to find in the middle of this dictionary, where ten becomes tempestus, and here was the drunk who was actually saying the whole thing, Stefano. So I summarize, here's who's who. Now on this list, you got Alfonso, Sebastian, Prospero, Antonio, Ferdinand, Gonzalo, Adrian, Caliban, Trinculo, Stefano, the master of the ship, the boatswain, the mariners, Miranda, the daughter, and Ariel. And then you got these three spirits, Juno, Ceres, and Idris, and then some nymphs and reapers. So I will summarize who is each, because I was able, in my mind, to decipher who they all were. The obvious one, D is Prospero. Stefano, Robert Stephanus, he nailed him because of that thing. And then the Jeffrey Torrey, the guy who had the I-O thing, he was Trinculo. You'll notice that the I-O, the I and the O, were part of the name. And Torrey, T-O-R-Y, T-O-R-Y. Back then, the Y and the I were pretty much the same letters. You can even see his name in there. And Gilberto was Gonzalo by the last thing that he had said. Antonio, that's pretty easy. Anthony Brigham, that's the name of the guy who did this preliminary expedition. Now, when I say is, I mean is a cryptic reference to the storyline that Shakespeare did was way far away from what we have here. But Shakespeare and Dee are commemorating this great event in Elizabethan history with this book, The Tempest, I claim. And so Peckham, is the guy that financed the expedition, the Catholics, he is Alonso. Now, after Sir Humphrey Gilbert drowned, he wrote a true report to try and get more people enthusiastic about settling it. And in it, he talks all about Alonso de Albuquerque, who was a Portuguese explorer who conquered all the lands bordering the Indian Ocean, all the way to India, Arabia, the whole thing. He was a great guy. You don't hear much about him, but you look him up. He was huge, and they knew about him in Elizabethan times. So Alonso is him. Now, Sebastian is a famous martyr, and he is generally shown with arrows in him and shone through him. Well, who was the biggest martyr in Elizabethan time? Sebastian was Sir Walter Raleigh, who was Sir Humphrey Gilbert's younger brother, made three expeditions, and had the patent of North America for Virginia, which is the Virgin Queen. And he got sent to the Tower of London because he was messing around with one of the Queen's maids and married her and without the Queen's approval. And then he actually gets his head cut off under King James. He was the martyr, and he just like Sebastian the martyr. Now, boatswain, a swain means a young servant, but boatswain sounds a lot like boatswain. Now, wain is another word for wagon, and they used to have this metaphor called a sailboat is like a winged wain. And so a hay wagon is a hay wain. The G, they just kind of left it out of there. And you'll know Constable later did a picture of the hay wain. Well, the boatswain is the hay guy, Edward Hayes, the hay wain. The whole thing is a riddle. Now you might say, no, they just didn't do riddles. That's all they did was riddles back then. We're the guys that don't do riddles. We have to understand them. In his report, Hayes, because he was the only surviving ship, he wrote this report that said, "We had also upon our main yard an apparition of a little fire by night, which seamen called Castor and Pollux." Well, that is called ball lightning or St. Elmo's fire. And in the Tempest, Ariel talks about flamed amazement, the same thing. So that's where Shakespeare or Dee got this idea from, I claim. Master of the wind, mister of the ship, that is William Winter. He was not only the owner of the Delight, but he also, in Act 1, Scene 1 of the Tempest, it said, "My hearts, cheerily, cheerily, my hearts, yeah, yeah," while this tempest is going on. Well, yeah, yeah means get ready, And so YY is like UU is like WW. It's like William Winter. Now, when I say they're the same thing, we see them as separate letters, but there were only like 23 letters in the Latin and English alphabet up until around Shakespeare's time. He was one of the first people to introduce the W and the J and the U. They were new letters around his time. So let's take Master and Winter. They end in the same thing, T-E-R, and their first letters are reflections of each other, and the other two letters are as in. The whole thing is one giant riddle. Now, who was Adrian in Act 2, Scene 2? A widow, Gonzalo says that Dido was from Tunis. And Adrian says, "Widow Dido," said you? "You make me a study of that. She was of Carthage, not of Tunis." "This tunage, sir, is Carthage," Gonzalo retorts. "Carthage? I assure you, Carthage. They're actually 10 miles apart from each other. They're not the same thing." Adrian was right. He was the geographer, even smarter than the Gonzalo. Who was the best geographer? Richard Hakluyt the Elder. He was Adrian, I claim. And in the word widow Dido, what they keep saying over and over and over again, you can see Iod in widow and in Dido. And so Francisco was his compatriot there. That was Richard Hakluyt the Younger, who was for 5 years a diplomat in France, Francisco. And he wrote Diverse Voyages, Touching Upon the Discovery of America, and Principal Navigations, very important books in Elizabeth. And there they are. They're the only two that are listed together, the two Hakluyt cousins, Richard, the guy with the same name. So Caliban, he represents Native Americans and the whole idea of them conquering the New World. What was important was they felt if they conquered the New World and they converted the Indians, that Jesus was going to come again. So, you know, whether you believe it or not, it doesn't matter. That's what they thought. It was a very important thing. So Ferdinand, that was not hard for me. That's Simon Fernandez. They had the same name. He was the Portuguese Englishman who not only made a preliminary expedition in 1580 to the New World to explore the Dee River, but also led the expeditions for Sir Walter Raleigh's three trips down to Roanoke Island. Here he, after the 1580 expedition, he went to Dee's house and gave him his sea cart, his map. He was exploring of the whole thing. Ariel, very easy. That is Aniel, or the Uriel, the angel that Dee talks to in his spirit talks with Edward Kelly. Miranda is kind of like three things in one. It's Madinia, who was Dee's daughter, who when she was 15 years old, she died of the plague. Dee was brokenhearted because when she was a child, he felt that she could communicate to the angels with him. And she was named after Madimi, who was one of the angels that Dee actually did contact with a few years earlier with Kelly. And so, but also, the Miranda is also Queen Elizabeth, in the sense that these are all three virgins and three virgin births. And so, and if you take out this R right here, you'll see all the letters of Miranda can be made from the letters of Madinia, very much the same. The three goddesses, that one was easy for me. Irish, Juno, and Ceres, I-I-C. You put the C backwards, that's John Dee's initials. Ionis, D, I, D, the three goddesses, a little riddle there. Now, Prospero asks Ariel at one point what she did with the king's ship. And she says, "Safely in harbor is the king's ship, in a deep nook where once thou callest me at midnight to fetch dew from the still vexed Bermuths. She's still there, she's still hid." Well, a safe harbor, another word for that is road, which is Dee's sacred code word for the mission of 1583. In other words, the Dee River, he called it road based on a riddle that he had put in. And so Bermuda is only, this is Bermuda on Dee's map of 1580. It's right off the coast of New England. It's actually closer to New England than it is from Georgia, although we think it's in the middle of the Atlantic someplace. So when he flies from at night, he's very close to it, as opposed to, I don't think he's over in Naples in Bermuda. So 1583, Don Bernardino de Mendoza, the head of the, he was the Spanish ambassador to England, living in London, he goes to the Queen, and he says, "As soon as we find out where that colony is going, we're going to slit the throats of every man, woman, and child we find there, just like we did at the Rabaul colony in Florida." So D had to have a secret code word, and the secret code symbol for the mission of 1583. The secret code symbol is the anchor of hope. And on the front cover of his book, he's got the anchor. And up at the top are anchor of hope crosses. This is, it says chi, a chi, and a rho. And there's the anchor, right? This is the anchor of hope. Jesus is the anchor of hope. Comes from Hebrews chapter 6. And road, his secret code word, is means rose in Greek. And here are the two roses that he puts up on the top of the thing. And just before he left, Sir Humphrey Gilbert was given by the Queen this charm. And on the charm, it's a queen holding an anchor. And it has 29 diamonds on it. And she has rubies on her crown. It's this very expensive thing. And on the back it says, "Tumor sub sacra ancora, be safeguarded by the sacred anchor." And up on the top are rubies shaped like roses on the crown. This is the Rhodes or Rhodes, and this is the anchor of hope, the symbol, D's code word and code symbol for it. Well, where did he get it? Well, Verrazano, 1524, calls the triangular island similar in size as the Isle of Rhodes, and D picked up on the metaphor, and he knew all about the triangular island that points to the mouth of the D River. At the end of the Monas, D says, "Amen," says the fourth letter, and he draws a triangle. Well, the fourth letter in Greek is alpha, beta, gamma, delta, and the fourth letter in Latin, A, B, C, D, that's his name. That was D's code signature of himself. He signed it thousands of times in his diaries. It was his code name. Well, on the front cover, look, he's got a tetrahedron Lady Occasion is standing on. That's four riddles about the triangular island, the D River, and in the tower, there's a triangular rock that points on the south, northwest, southwest arch right to the mouth of the D River. The whole thing is one big riddle. And in the Tempest, you'll notice the structure of it is that they have the Tempest and the groups, the King's Men, and then there's the two drunks, and then there's Fernando. They all get split up, and they all end up going to the center of the island. Well, I claim it was a triangular island, and they both made their route there, and that's where he gets forgiven by Prospero and the whole thing. And that whole thing is the triangular island that Dee's talking about. Now, in the 1600s, the first governor of Rhode Island was Benedict Arnold, not the traitor, his great-great-grandfather, and he was the one that owned the tower. He was the first one here in 1636. He claimed the tower, and he was the one that named this place Road. I claim because he knew, called by us Rhode Island in 1637, because he knew about D, he knew about the clue, he knew about the alignments in the tower, and Roger Williams wanted it named Patmos, the island in the Aegean Sea where St. John wrote Revelation. But no, this guy insisted because he was the badass. He was the main trading factor between the Narragansetts and the people of Boston, whereas Williams had been kicked out of Boston. He couldn't even go there if he wanted to. So this guy, Benedict Arnold, knew the whole thing. He was appointed by King Charles to be the first governor. He was reelected seven times. When he died, 1,000 people attended his funeral, and he's totally ignored in Rhode Island history. Why? Because we're Americans, and we're taught the word name Benedict Arnold means traitor. We don't want him in our history. We got to wake up. There is his first symbol, hope, the anchor of hope, Benedict Arnold, 1663. It's still our symbol today. Two last clues about road and hope, because there are clues all in the book about it. In the word prospero, you can find the word rose, R, actually spelled in the correct way, R-O-S-E, and rose means road. The whole thing is a little riddle. And also in the word prospero, you find the word spero, which in Latin means hope and rose. D figured out a word that had both of his secret clues in the whole thing. And Miranda, the daughter of Prospero, means, in Italian, watchtower. And that's what a tower was, the tower of the watchtower. So in other words, I claim they collaborated on this. Now, certainly the words are all Shakespeare, but D was the trunk, the roots, and the meat of it, the story of his life, and this idea of the exploration. D was Shakespeare was the leaves, and he was the twigs, and the branches are their collaboration. In other words, D gave it structure. Shakespeare breathed life into it. Two of the most brilliant minds in Elizabethan times, I claim they co-wrote The Tempest. and that Prospero Cell is actually the Dondi Tower of 1583, and all the characters represent characters in the Tempest. So it's really hard to understand this book, and I don't advise reading it until you've read Elizabethan America. This is my Tempest book, 500 pages. But once I get started, I'm like, hey, this must be, I'm on to something here. But first, read Elizabethan America. It's smaller, and you understand what I'm talking about. That nobody's going to understand my Shakespeare thing unless they know about this colonization effort and this beautiful tower. And the best way is to come visit the tower and see it in different lights. The beautiful fireplace is all still there, beautiful structure, and it's terribly romantic. We just spent $40,000, a bunch of neighbors, and we got new lights on it at night. And right across the street is the Newport Tower Museum. I get so excited, I open up this museum right across the street. I've had 7,000 people from all over the world. Nobody from Rhode Island ever comes, but people from all over come. And so you're welcome to come here. And it's what I claim that is the birth of the British Empire, because that was the term which John Dee coined. And I claim this place is the birth of the British Empire right here in Newport, Rhode Island. And the whole thing was started by my man, the John Dee, the British Empire, by my man, John Dee. Thus endeth the lesson. Thank you.
Cheers, cheers, cheers. Fabulous, cool. Well, James, this is going to be an archetypal video, and I'm sure that lots of people will enjoy it. But just a real quickie that's sort of burning here is, you know, Teresa and I, Terry Burns, we've been postulating also that the Tempest had a symbolism for somehow John Dee being responsible for the storm that took out the Spanish Armada, with the metaphor being that if you can call plasma angelics, their big plasma bodies, you can steer tornadoes. So there's another sort of level of meaning in there. Would you want to comment on that? Or?
Well, there could be something to that. You know, what I've taken it as is a little more, you know, not quite as angelic. You know, at the time, Dee was in Prague during the Spanish Armada. But yeah, I think all of this stuff is related. I mean, I don't really clearly understand all of the connections. I've just sort of like, I mean, in other words, I'm not an academic. I'm a photographer. I'm an amateur historian. You know, I don't study all of this stuff, and I'm learning as I'm going. In fact, when I write, that's when I learn. In other words, the things develop.
Well,
so
I think the myth is that
between all the storms,
The myth is that John Dee somehow used the seven sacred sites, the seven hills of Prague, invoking, and it's another long story. But it's just a fun parallel here. But also, James, there was another question here about, you see the question about, was John Dee actually in the Americas, do you think, or?
Oh, no, he actually never came here. The Queen didn't want anybody leaving. In fact, she didn't even want Sir Humphrey Gilbert to come on the first mission, because she said he's not a very good hap by sea, which means he's not very lucky at sea. And she was absolutely right. He ended up killing himself. But she didn't want Dee to go. She didn't want Gilbert to go. She didn't want Raleigh to go. For Sir Philip Sidney got on a horse and rode down to Gilbert's ship, and he says, like, I want to go. I want to be the first one in America. And the Queen says, no, I forbid you. You can't go. She knew that the main courtiers or main guys, she didn't want to lose them all on this stuff. She would rather send, you know, the Catholics or send some preliminary, send the prisoners to us. You know, it's like they send people to get things started. Then you guys can go. So Dee never came across here, but he would love to have seen his tower. I do think that he knew that it got built, and that he knew that some year, maybe around 2017, some people would become more aware of it.
And just a quickie, another quickie, James. What do you think of the thought that where the light actually crossed at the center point between the two cones or tetra or whatever, it actually creates the kind of implosion that is the essence of what it is to conjure.
Yes. Yeah. I think there is something to that. Bucky calls that. He says, envision these two tip-to-tip tetrahedra as coming, collapsing each on each side. When did they get to the center? He says, that's the point of vanishment. He says, they get so small, they vanish. And then they come out the other side, but they vanish. And he says, that's our definition of a geometric point. A thing that has a position in space, but has no size and has no dimension. So Yeah, I absolutely think there's much more to it than this geometric point.
Exactly.
I don't know what happens in that
would be the perfect collapse point, and therefore the place where all waves meet, and thus the possibility of fusion, communion, and what physics now knows is phase condensation creates negentropy, self-organization, and literally how you would commune with giant plasma beings, which is really, you know, the Queen's conjurer to conjure.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I think all of this stuff is related. I think my talking about it is a fairly simplistic way, but when Bucky talks about the center point here, he says it's like the Grand Central Station, and these are all trains going in, and that's the place where everything crisscrosses. That's where the magic is. And he calls it the number 9, which is this this null number that appears this way in, you know, in number. And so, yeah, there's much more magic to it than what I've described.
Well, yes, and I think that takes people to a kind of a next step that people say, well, you can get lost in numerology. But if you always refer it back to pure wave mechanics and predict something a wave could do, then you get to pure principles from the numerology of the pure principle of waves. And even the number 9 is now plasma physics. The 9 plasma toroid self-organized. This is Los Alamos. So anyway... We're past time.
That's why I tell this, because I want people to make more connections between what you're coming at it, and I'm kind of, everyone comes from a different thing. So this is just my silly way of coming at it, but it's from historical and mathematical, and it's an interdisciplinary thing. Bucky calls himself a comprehensivist, someone who's interested in all these different subjects and sees how they are all interrelated. That's what Dee was. He was an interdisciplinarian. He was a true Renaissance man, and that's why they both figured out the same thing. Bucky was a product of the American Renaissance. Buckminster Fuller's aunt was Margaret Fuller, one of the great transcendentalist thinkers in the 1850s in New England with Ralph Waldo Emerson and Henry David Thoreau. The three of them wrote The Dial. And this was his great aunt. So Bucky is a product of all of this stuff. And Dee was a product of great Renaissance thinkers, all the great Italian thinkers. And Dee's 4,000 book library, he assimilated all of it. And so somehow knowledge gets learned, but sometimes it gets lost. So let's not have it get lost this time.
Beautiful, really. Well, cheers, and thank you. Thank you to everybody. Thank you for staying with us. So this video will be an archetype. Thank you. Congratulations to James Egan. We'll put this video up in a day or two, and we'll continue the dialogue. Blessings. Thank you so much. Congratulations, James Egan. To everybody, you can buy James Egan's book.
There you go. I'm not here to promote it, but I'm here to have some fun. And trust me, I hope you guys all had some fun, because I had more fun than anybody, I think. Ho, ho, ho.
There's John D. Goodbye, everybody. Thank you.
Remember the IOD. Remember the IOD.
The IOTA. Thank you. Bye-bye.